Every time I talk about Diffie Hellman and use any kind of analogy, people were like, oh, show us the maths, show us the maths. I could have taken the maths. So this is for the maths people. Right? If you want to know how mathematically Diffie Hellman works, watch this video. If you don't want to know that, there's a nice close button in the top corner, or a back button, you know, be my guest. So that this is for mathematically inclined people. Let's go back to where we were before. So we have Alice, and we've got Bob, and we've got our public area here, sort of public, and we're going to draw down here. Now, the mathematics behind Diffie-Hellman is usually modulo arithmetic. Recall that we have our public numbers G and N. G is often very small, it's usually a small prime number. N is often very big and needs to be big for the security of this to work. N is often 2,000 bits long, or 4,000 bits is more common now. So N is very, very big. It can't be too big because you won't gain much in security, but you lose in efficiency. So, you know, you have to think about that. Alice and Bob need to pick their numbers A and B. So Alice picks a number A, Bob picks a number B. These are the ones they're going to keep private. Now, A is somewhere between 1 and N, but it's random. And N is so vast that it's not going to be 1. It's going to be a very big number. Let's not worry about what it is. She's not going to tell anyone what that is. Same for Bob. The first thing Alice does is she calculates G to the power of A mod N. Right? Now, modulo, if you do any programming, you'll be familiar with the percent symbol, is the remainder after division. So another way of looking at modulo is to have this kind of clock face. So if we have a clock face, which should be a circle, and we go from 1, 2, 3, all the way round to N. These are the numbers modulo N. So when we perform some arithmetic in this space, we just go round and round the clock face. We don't ever leave and go above N or below 0. In fact, this should be 0 as well. There should be a 0 in here. So when you do G to the power of A mod N, what happens is you're raising G to the power of some massive number, which would be very normally very big, but in actual fact, it just goes round and round this clock face and ends up somewhere. So let's say G to the A mod N arrives somewhere here on the clock face. Now, what's important about this is it's very difficult, given this, to work out what A was. Right? We know G is, let's say, 3. Right? If I say we're here on the clock face and we started at 3, what number is A? It's just impossible to know, right? Because its position on this clock has no bearing on how many times it's gone round or what A was at all, right? The only way to do this is essentially to brute force it, to go, well, is it A to the power of 1? No, it's not. Is it A to the power of 2? No. And so on and so forth for an infeasible amount of time.
We did a little bit of this with the hashing video, didn't we? There was a little bit of the modulo function there in calculating the hash.
Yeah, so that was used to shorten something at the end, but it's the same kind of principle. Modulo is very useful for taking something that could be any length and putting it into a sort of finite loop, a finite group of actual numbers. Now, Bob, we're going to take G to the B mod N. So let's say that turns up over here somewhere. So this is G to the B mod N. So again, what we've done is we've taken G, we've raised it to the power of B, and we've done all of this modulo N, which means that it just, if it ever goes above N, it just loops back round to zero and keeps going. So this is somewhere else. These are their two public components, so they share these like this. So now these are public, but again, calculating A and B from this is very, very difficult. It's called solving the discrete log problem, and practically very, very difficult for even a supercomputer. Right. Now, Alice is going to take this, I'm just going to simplify the notation slightly to make it fit on the page, but Alice is going to take the G to the B that Bob sent and raise it again to the power of A mod N. And Bob is going to take G to the A that Alice sent and raise it to the power of B mod N. And anyone that's done any exponentiation knows that if you do something to the power of something to the power of something else, it's actually just those two things multiplied. So it's G to the AB mod N. That's the answer. So that will produce, that will come somewhere around, you know, let's say here. Right, so this is G to the AB mod N. Now, this will be some number between 0 and N. Bob's done the same thing. He's also got G to the AB mod N, and they're exactly the same. These are two identical colours we were looking at in our colour example. So they've both arrived at the exact same position in this group, despite the fact that neither of them knew what each other's private key was. That's what's really cool about Diffie-Hellman. To try and reverse this process, we have to know A or B. We know publicly G to the A, and we also know G to the B. If we try and multiply them together, for example, we'll get G to the A plus B, which is not the same. Right, that's me sort of mixing my public colours together in the hope of getting the right answer. I haven't got it. That'll be somewhere else, a completely different number. Remember, this is cryptography. If you're one position out, it's not going to decrypt. Right? So, you know, you have to get it exactly right.
The fact that she's got G to the B to the A is no different to G to the A to the B.
It's exactly the same. I mean, you could look at an example. If you went 2 to the power of 2 to the power of 3, that's 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, right? Which is 2 to the 6, because there's 6 of them. You can do it in any order. It doesn't matter. You get the same number out at the end.
Whereas that is a completely different thing.
Yeah, so that is equivalent of 2 to the power of 2 times 2 to the power of 3, which is 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, which is 2 to the 5, entirely different number. Now, those numbers are fairly similar because these examples are small. You're just going to be somewhere else completely on this modular arithmetic clock face. It's not going to work at all.
The n number is kind of important though, is it right?
It's mostly important that n is big, because if n is small, then in essence, this clock face is going to have only a few numbers on it. You can brute force that very quickly. Right? You can find the value of A or the value of B and reverse this process. If N is, you know, astronomically large, like 2,000 or 4,000 bits, the amount of time it's going to take you to find the correct values for A or B is, I mean, essentially, it's long enough that you won't bother. That's the argument. It's technically possible, but they'd be long dead by the time you did it. And so you finding out what image they sent each other is not that useful. Actually, this is quite simple, right? I mean, let's not underplay it. This is incredibly important for computer science and mathematics, but it's actually not that complicated in some sense. It's very elegant. If you want to see some worked examples of this, Wikipedia and other websites have lots of small examples with small numbers so that you can work this through if you want to have a go at the maths yourself, right? And you'll get the same answer out, and it's impressive.